You're live with Lewis Vaughan Jones on BBC World News, remembering Japan's Shinzo Abe. This is the scene live in Tokyo, where a vigil is being held for the former Prime Minister. Shinzo Abe was assassinated at an election event on Friday. And Shinzo Abe's political legacy lives on. The process to change Japan's constitution to become a non-pacifist nation could begin after Sunday's election result. Also on the programme, Sri Lanka's president confirms he will resign. The presidential palace is now a protest site as crowds continue to pour in.
How does it feel to swim in the president's personal pool?
I'm happy. I'm so happy.
15 people have been killed after a Russian rocket hit an apartment building in the town of Chasiv Yar in eastern Ukraine. And squirrels going nuts for contraceptives as British scientists hope to control an expanding population. In the next half hour, we'll be live in Tokyo and we'll have the latest from our correspondents in Colombo and Kyiv. Hello and welcome to the programme. We're going to start in Japan, where a vigil for the former Prime Minister Shinzo Abe has been taking place in Tokyo. Mr. Abe was shot dead at an election event on Friday. Well, Japanese media say his wife led the ceremony, which was attended by politicians and close friends. Earlier today, the US Secretary of State, Antony Blinken, made a previously unscheduled stop in Tokyo to offer condolences to the Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida. His funeral will take place on Tuesday. Well, let's go live now to Tokyo. Our correspondent, Mariko Oi, is there. Hi, Mariko. So just talk us through what's happening there right now.
Well, I'm standing outside Zojoji Temple, which is where the vigil has been taking place for about an hour now. We saw Fumio Kishida, the country's current prime minister, one of the first visitors to pay visit. We saw his car actually leaving from the temple about half an hour ago as well. But there were also more than 100 guests about 30 minutes before the vigil started, including, we understand, that the British ambassador will be coming here as well sometime tonight. So this event could go on for quite some time. And this is an event that's traditionally held the night before the funeral for Mr. Abe. So the funeral will be taking place inside the same temple starting at noon local time tomorrow.
And Mariko, people there, of course, reflecting on what a huge political legacy he left. And given the election results on Sunday, one of his big political aims could come to fruition.
Indeed. So on Sunday, only 2 days after Mr. Abe's shocking assassination, the country went ahead with the upper house elections and the ruling Liberal Democratic Party of Japan had a resounding victory. It was always expected to win. But now the ruling party, along with its coalition partner, have more than two thirds of the seats. And that means that Mr. Kishida, the current prime minister, could try and go ahead to change the pacifist constitution of Japan, which, as you said, has been something that Mr. Abe has been very, very passionate about. I was watching local TV earlier this morning and a lot of lawmakers from the ruling party who won the elections, they were saying that they wanted to dedicate their victory to Mr. Abe.
And more broadly, what do you think his legacy will be now as Japan reflects on that over the days and weeks to come?
It was interesting. A couple of days ago, we were asking people out on the street, you know, how would you remember Mr. Abe? You know, what's the one thing that you would remember Mr. Abe for? And almost all the answers were quite different. You know, one person said Abe no mask. So he was the prime minister who distributed a free face mask at the beginning of the pandemic. You know, it was somewhat criticized because the mask was too small and so on. But, you know, that particular supporter was very fond fond of that memory, saying that, you know, he was able to make big decisions like closing schools immediately, which obviously took a bit of gut to take, according to her. Also, other people cited Abenomics, you know, the economic policies that are known even outside of Japan, where Mr. Abe worked very closely with the Bank of Japan, the country's central bank, to pump billions of dollars into the economy, to shore up the economy. Investors loved it, you know, the stock market did so well, but his critics would argue that it widened the wealth gap between the rich and the poor. Others also talked about the foreign relations. You know, Mr. Abe was known to have traveled all around the world, to have close ties with global leaders. Of course, he was the prime minister when former US President President Obama came to visit Hiroshima, where an atomic bomb was dropped, and Mr. Abe was there. He then visited Pearl Harbor with Mr. Obama. But then when Mr. Trump was elected, he was the first leader to visit him in his personal home. So all sorts of things that people remember him for.
Mariko, thanks so much for talking us through the events there in Tokyo. Thank you. And Ken Moriyasu is the diplomatic correspondent at Nikkei Asia. He says Shinzo Abe wanted to change Japan's constitution because he recognised the threats the country faced.
The constitution renounces the use of force as a means to settle international conflicts and also prohibits Japan from having land, air and sea forces. Abe-san wasn't opposed to that, but he wanted to write in that Japan also has a self-defense force. The current constitution kind of ignores the fact that Japan does a has a self-defense force. So he wanted to make that clear and make clear that Japan needs to prepare itself for any contingency. To do that, he needed political capital. That's why he focused on the economy to shore up his support. Once the support was there, he wanted to conduct the constitutional reforms. But because the legal procedures, the legislative procedures of changing the constitution is pretty high, he compensated for that by altering some of the existing laws to expand what Japan could do, not so much focus on what Japan could not do. And I think here the most important thing is not that Abe wanted to change the constitution, but that Abe had a very strategic vision of what Japan needed to do. And that strategy was forced around how to deal with China. He was very clear that China was the threat and that Japan had to prepare for it. And I think he looked at Japan. He thought the worst case scenario for Japan was to have a three-front problem: China, North Korea, and Russia. And he tried to eliminate one of those threats, which is Russia, by reaching out to Vladimir Putin and engaging in diplomacy with Russia, although it was very unpopular among the Japanese public. But he succeeded in that. But unfortunately, right now, after the Ukraine war, Japan is faced with a three-front problem. And there is talk about doubling the defense budget. But with a three-front war, people are saying maybe Japan needs to triple its defense budget. So to counter that, Japan really needs to have to reduce one of those threats diplomatically.
Thanks to Ken Moriyasu for that. And of course, we'll be back in Japan over the next minutes and hours with the latest on that vigil. Next, though, to Sri Lanka, where President Gotabaya Rajapaksa has confirmed he will resign after having fled when crowds stormed his palace. It's not clear whether, as suggested, he will return to the country this week to formally quit. Hundreds of protesters, furious about corruption and economic mismanagement, are still in the presidential house and grounds. They say they won't leave until Rajapaksa has gone. Our South Asia correspondent, Rajini Vaidyanathan, reports from Colombo.
These scenes would have been unthinkable days ago. Sri Lanka's seat of presidential power, now a sightseeing destination. Security nowhere to be seen, as thousands push their way in to a palace taken over by protesters.
This is a really surreal moment for Sri Lanka. A building that is normally heavily fortified, now a free-for-all.
At President Gotabaya Rajapaksa's private pool, we meet carpenter Ruan Chaminda, who's taking a dip. A moment of relief after he walked hours to join the protests.
My kids are hungry. We don't have fuel. We don't have cooking gas. We don't even have fuel to do our jobs properly.
How does it feel
to swim in the president's personal pool.
I'm happy. I'm so happy.
Moments of joy and curiosity. But where does this leave the future of the island? The man who once lived here, President Gotabaya Rajapaksa, has now fled and is expected to step down this week.
A lot of the people here need to also witness the fact that how rich and wealthy and luxurious their lives are. Even this place, how grand, how big the house is, whereas people have been dying and have been suffering to fight for their basic necessities.
As they look around the lavish rooms, Sri Lankans continue to contend with a deepening economic crisis.
Is this the right thing to do? Is this the right way to go about it, storming the presidential palace?
Well, if the people have been demanding for the president to decently step down, with respect, we've asked him to step down multiple times. So if the people were realizing that, well, unless we physically go and take him out of the chair, he's not going to leave.
And when will your protest stop? When will you be satisfied?
When will I personally be satisfied? If we go to a new election, and hopefully people will vote for principles and morals and ideals that the person running for the election holds and not the person itself. Because when it comes to politics in Sri Lanka, it's personality central.
After months of frustration, this feels like a release. Crowds surging through the doors to get inside this presidential palace and get a peek of what life is like, Sri Lanka's political class.
A palace overrun, a country in crisis. Protesters say they won't leave until the president officially quits. But even once he does, who can save this nation in need? For Sri Lanka, the challenges keep on coming. Ujini Vaidyanathan, BBC News, Colombo.
Well, let's speak now to Kumar Sangakkara, cricket commentator and former Sri Lanka cricket captain. Thank you very much for coming on the programme.
Thank you for having me.
So, first of all, we've seen those pictures of hundreds of people in the presidential grounds, in the presidential palace. What's your reaction to seeing that?
Well, I think it's been very inspiring and at times surreal to see the citizen activism movement that has taken Sri Lanka to a place where there is the possibility and the grounds for a new beginning in terms of our political structures and our social structures. So what does
that look like, a new beginning? What do you mean by that? Is that just fresh elections, or what are you asking for?
Well, I think it has been very clear what the demands of the people of Sri Lanka have been over the past months. It has been the resignation of the president and the prime minister. And if and when they do come, it is the formulation of a caretaker government, a united government, an inclusive government, and then a clear timeline for elections. And elections are going to be very critical, because for the people of Sri Lanka, there is also the consideration where how is this citizen activism, this popular movement, can be negotiated and converted into a contract of government through their own elected representatives. And so to be able to do that and convert this movement into a sustainable democracy, elections are going to be absolutely important within an acceptable timeline.
Well, I mean, you've identified exactly the challenge there, haven't you? It's that conversion of that demand for change into a real impact and lasting change, because the effects that people have been living through in Sri Lanka have been devastating over the last few weeks and months and longer.
Yes, they have been. I think Andrew Fidel Fernando has written an article for the BBC that vividly portrays the hardships the Sri Lankan people have gone through. And it is probably not my place to comment on it, because I am of a certain level of privilege that allows me to get by even in the hardest of times in the country. But for so many hundreds of thousands in Sri Lanka, their daily lives, their livelihoods have been completely completely upended, with every day bringing more heartbreak, more hardship, lack of fuel, lack of food, lack of schooling, lack of electricity, the inability to go to work, lack of essential medicines, and the list goes on, and the people have suffered. And it just gets really difficult to see, but it is immensely difficult for people in Sri Lanka to live through.
And Kumar, you outlined that you want to see this this kind of action, citizen action, transfer to elections as quickly as possible. There are some in Sri Lanka who are frankly sceptical. They know that the president has said he will resign, but until he actually does, they're not going to believe it. Are you confident that this week he will go?
I hope that is the case. I think the situation has become untenable if there were a different outcome other than that. The protesters, the citizen activists, the civil interest groups that have taken part on the streets, putting their bodies, their safety on the line for all of us, for people like me, for our children and for the future of our country. They've been overwhelmingly peaceful. They're young, they're savvy, they're courageous. Yeah. And they have inspired Sri Lankans from all different backgrounds social divides and different ideologies to come together.
Kumar, I'm afraid I have to leave it there, but your point there is very well heard, and we hear you loud and clear. Kumar Sangakkara, thank you very much for sharing your thoughts with us here on the BBC. Thank you.
Thank you.
Right, you are live with Lewis Vaughan-Jones, still to come. The squirrels going nuts for contraceptives as British scientists hope to control an expanding population. And we'll have the very latest live from Kyiv on the war in Ukraine too.
After months of talks and missed deadlines, a deal has been struck to keep Greece within the eurozone. The immediate prospect of Greece going bust in the worst crisis to hit the eurozone has been averted.
Emergency services across Central Europe are stepping up their efforts to contain the worst floods this century. Nearly 100 people have been killed.
Broadway is traditionally called the Great White Way by Americans, but tonight it's completely blacked out. It's a timely reminder to all Americans of the problems that the energy crisis has brought to them.
Leaders meet in Paris for a summit on pollution, inflation, and third world debt. This morning they joined the revolution celebrations for a show of military might on the Champs-Élysées.
Wildlife officials in Australia have been coping with a penguin problem. Fairy penguins have been staggering ashore and collapsing after gorging themselves on huge shoal of their favourite food, pilchards. Some had eaten so much they could barely stand.
Welcome back. You're live with Lewis Vaughan-Jones. To Ukraine now. President Zelensky has reportedly ordered a force of up to 1 million men to retake the south of the country from the Russians. Well, that's according to his defense minister. Weeks of relentless attacks by Russia turned entire towns and cities such as Mariupol into a wasteland, with estimates that thousands of civilians have been killed. Well, we've heard from a British newspaper that the new offensive is needed to retake coastal areas vital to the country's economy. Our correspondent in Kyiv is Joe Inwood. And he says Oleksiy Reznikov appears to be putting the focus on Ukraine's south.
So this was quite an interesting intervention from Oleksiy Reznikov speaking to the Times newspaper. He talked about a couple of things. Firstly, the idea that Ukraine has 1 million people at its disposal for its armed forces. Those aren't all going to be concentrated in one area but spread across the theatre. But I think he was trying to give an impression of the size of their army and the extent to which they're going to be able to resist the Russians as a consequence. In terms of where those forces are focused, he was talking, and I thought this was really interesting, about the importance of the south. Now, a lot of the attention of the media, of politicians, has been on the east, the Donbass area, because that's where the Russians are massing their forces and they're on the offensive. But it is the south, really, that many people think is more strategically important for the Ukrainians. The real risk for Ukraine in this conflict is that they become landlocked, that Russia would take the entire coast of the Azov Sea and the Black Sea all the way down to Odessa, because being landlocked would really damage the Ukrainian economy in the long run. And I think what we saw is the suggestion from Mr. Reznikov that they're going to be launching a counter-offensive demonstrates the extent to which the Ukrainian leadership know that. Indeed, it tallies with sounds we've got from other senior figures. Irina Verichuk, the deputy prime minister, has said to people in occupied areas in the south to get out of the way because Ukrainian forces are going to be launching a counter-offensive. Now, it's not going to be an easy task, but it is a task the Ukrainians are clearly set on.
Thanks to Joe for that update. Next, leaked documents show how Uber secretly lobbied UK politicians to help change transport policy in London. In meetings, which were never declared, Uber's lobbyists met George Osborne when he was Chancellor and a number of ministers, including Conservative leadership candidate Sajid Javid. The documents were leaked to The Guardian newspaper and shared with the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists and BBC Panorama. Uber denies its lobbying was secret and the ministers say rules were followed. Richard Bilton reports.
When Uber arrived in London, there was chaos. Black cab drivers weren't happy and blockaded the capital. The then London mayor, Boris Johnson, set up a review that could have limited Uber's expansion in the capital. The leaked documents show Uber was on a secret offensive, a concerted campaign to influence policy. George Osborne, the then Chancellor, went to a private dinner in California with Uber's chief exec, Travis Kalanick. An internal Uber email says it's better than a meeting in London because this is a much more private affair with no hanger-on officials or staffers. The meeting was never declared.
The danger is that if people start to think politicians are making cosy deals behind closed doors, they lose trust in democracy. It undermines the fabric of our society and the health of our democracy.
There were a series of meetings with ministers. None were declared. The leaked documents show Uber felt it got what it wanted. They describe George Osborne as a strong advocate who would take up our cause when needed. And they boast that then Prime Minister David Cameron's senior staff are very with us. Ultimately, Boris Johnson abandoned the proposals and Uber was allowed more drivers. Uber says new management has transformed every aspect of how the company operates and its engagements with government are legal and transparent. The ministers say they properly complied with the declaration rules, and George Osborne says it was public policy to meet and persuade tech companies to invest in Britain. Richard Bilton, BBC News.
Next, squirrels like nuts. Everyone knows that. So here in the UK, where the number of grey squirrels has increased rapidly, scientists have come up with a novel way of controlling the population. Hazelnut paste laced with contraceptives. Justin Rowlatt explains.
He looks like another charming woodland creature. But grey squirrels are actually dangerous interlopers, responsible for killing and maiming tens of thousands of young trees every year and devastating the population of this little fellow, the UK's native red squirrel. The traditional way of disposing of pests like grey squirrels works in the short run, but people don't like furry animals being shot, and anyway, it's a temporary solution. Grey squirrels breed rapidly and populations can recover quickly, which is why government scientists are exploring a more humane alternative.
Whoa. Now, you won't be surprised to hear that squirrels just love this. It's a kind of hazelnut butter. They find it irresistible. And what the scientists are doing is dosing this with contraceptives. Now, the idea is the squirrels will be unaffected, except, of course, they won't be able to produce any young.
But how do you ensure only grey squirrels eat it? Well, the scientists have come up with a cunning plan.
So it has a weighted door at the front that an animal has to push open to access the bait.
And this is the bait here, so that's that paste.
Yeah, it has a metal case to keep out larger animals, and we raise it up on a stand so that smaller animals can't access it.
But where do you get squirrel contraceptives? The team are investigating two long-lasting birth control treatments. The lead scientist on the team says progress has been good. She hopes it will be ready to roll out in the wild within 2 years.
You could reduce them significantly, like bring them to the brink of local extinction, or even eradicate them from some areas, provided that you can do a coordinated control over large areas.
Reducing the population of grey squirrels should help protect the remaining reds. It could save the timber industry millions of pounds a year and should also help tackle climate change by reducing damage to the vast new forests the government has promised to plant to soak up carbon dioxide emissions. So it looks like the only loser is the grey squirrel. Justin Rowlatt, BBC News, the Yorkshire Dales National Park.
Now, just before I go, the Aboriginal flag will permanently replace the New South Wales flag on top of the Sydney Harbour Bridge. It says the government has abandoned plans to install an expensive new flagpole. The Aboriginal flag had been flying over the Sydney Harbour Bridge this past week. That's it. I'm Lewis Vaughan-Jones. This is BBC News.
Hello, another heatwave is underway across western parts of Europe with temperatures reaching 40 or above in some spots, I mean 40 Celsius for a high in Lisbon in Portugal, for example, parts of Spain over 40, close to that in France in the coming days, temperatures lifting into the 30s across parts of the United Kingdom as well. There's scorching sunshine, of course, along with all of that. It's a different story further east across Europe and some heavy rain through parts of Finland and down towards the Baltic countries and into western parts of Russia, maybe some quite brisk winds along with that as well. A drier picture for Monday down towards the southeast and into Turkey, where temperatures are at or below average for the time of year. But there's certainly that heat around again through much of Iberia, France, and in the coming days expanding too into central areas of Europe and in London. Well, that heat wave could well last for much, if not all, of the week ahead. And again on Tuesday, although a lot of places will be seeing the sunshine more widely through central Europe, it's that area of low pressure here which is bringing those downpours again, Finland, Baltic countries and into parts of Western Russia. Let's take a look at our city forecast now. And in London, with temperatures like this, that would qualify it as a heat wave, and not just for the rest of the week, but through the following weekend as well. It's going to be hot in Paris, that's for sure, and Madrid as well. We'll see those temperatures heading up in Vienna also. That's it for now. I'll see you again soon.